ये कुछ मुझे डायरेक्शन देनी पड़ रही है बिकॉज दिस वर्कशॉप इज गोइंग टू बी रिकॉर्डेड एंड अल्टीमेटली बी ऑन सीडी एज वेल सो ठीक इस वाले में फिर ये कि थोड़ी बहुत मूवमेंट रहेगी तो यहाँ भी किसी को रहे स्टार्ट बिकॉज वी हैव अ लिमिटेड टाइम सो इंटरेक्टिव वर्कशॉप ऑन बेसिक्स ऑफ ECG रिमेंबर वी आर जस्ट गोइंग टू कवर द बेसिक्स यू ऑलरेडी नो बुनियाद From where to start? Now remember, ECG is. We all know what ECG is. First, certainly we need to know what is ECG. ECG is 12 lead recording of electrical activity generated by the heart. This is ECG, and you see it by 12 different angles. So that's why the same activity. Is recorded in 12 different fashions, in 12 different leads, isn't it? Now this is ECG. Now why we do it? That's the key question. Because you are in NICVD, it's very easy because everyone comes with ECG. You take history after, and he got his ECG before even history and examination. But what about when you are at a place? But you have to order yourself that which patient needs ECG. Because whenever you assess, remember you assess first clinically and then judge by yourself that which of your patient needs ECG. Most of the time we think that ECG is something which is there to assess acute ischemia, that's it. Most of the time. But that's not the case. Let's see. What are the areas where you need ECG? And ECG is actually one of the tool which helps you in your management in a way that it helps you in assessing diagnosis, getting clues towards patient's clinical status as well, and sometimes even consequences of many conditions you can assess by ECG. And let's see. Then why we do ECG? Firstly, monitor patient heart rate and rhythm. That is the most important indication for ECG. It means whenever you are assessing a patient on clinical ground and you found anything wrong with rate and rhythm, or you expect anything wrong with rate and rhythm, this patient can be stable unstable. Now remember, all of your ACLS is dependent on what? Rhythm assessment, not even pulse, rhythm assessment. What's the rhythm? And there you need ECG knowledge for save patient's life. And that ECG assessment is just for seconds, looking at the telemetry and assessing what's going on and do appropriate action accordingly. So that's the most important indication of ECG, assessing patient's rate and similarly, when you assess someone's clinically and you found two extremes of rate, don't assume by yourself that if someone is having heart rate of 50, don't assume it to be sinus bradycardia. It can be anything, and that can only be answered by ECG. Similarly, a rate of 120, 30, which is persistent, don't again assume sinus tachycardia. It can be any other rhythm. So assessing rate and rhythm is the most important indication for doing ECG. So whenever you see a patient where you think there is a problem with heart rate or even rhythm in a stable patient, this indirectly says that you have to assess every patient's pulse if you are a cardiologist. Even a person who is having sinus rhythm in the previous visit can have atrial fibrillation this time. And so ECG indication really can come from this, your from your clinical assessment. If you assess patient's pulse and found anything wrong there, always order ECG to get what's the rhythm. So that's the first indication. Second is evaluate the effect of disease or injury on heart function. Now this is so broad, you can't imagine. Once you got really expert in ECG, you come to know what are the clues of how many diseases you can get from ECG. Acute, chronic, cardiac, non-cardiac, and there are hundreds of diseases. Just ECG gives you a clue and you proceed further and found the right diagnosis. So, and in indirect way, remember that this ECG is a very simple test, can easily be done at every place. Just a machine, a technician, and you can read, and can make major decisions. This ECG can shift a patient from ER to cath lab, and you do coronary primary angioplasty on this patient. This ECG leads to cardioversion. So all major cardiac decisions are dependent on ECG. Pulmonary embolism, oh, so many diseases, cardiac and non-cardiac. So that means it's important for you to know all the clues which you can found in different conditions in ECG, so that whenever your clinical judgment guides you towards anything, the simple available investigations gives you clue and you can go towards that condition. So important. Detect presence of electrolyte and other metabolic disturbances as well. So a very comprehensive net of assessment which you can do with the help of ECG. This is the basic need to be known to everyone who really interpret ECG, so that you can utilize this tool in every condition wherever it can be. Even in a chronic stable patients, you can do ECG and assess a lot of thing about the patient's background. Now reading ECG, there are some basics you need to know before going to the ECG strip. Firstly, the surface anatomy, in a way that where the heart is lying beneath the chest, and that's the basic you all know. Then in this heart, what are the thing which is generating ECG or forming those electrical waves, and what's the propagation road for that? And this you all know from your basics, SA, AV, bundle. Now why they are important? Whenever you see a single complex, just try to contemplate from where this complex is originating and what path this conduction is following. Is it following normal path with normal intervals, or there is something wrong with conduction? Similarly, even origin of the rhythm, is there any problem with the origination of the rhythm? Is it originating from the right place or not? So that means whenever you see a rhythm strip, the first complex P, okay, maybe sinus or atria, PR interval within limits, so this conduction stops for a normal period of time at AV node. Then a narrow QRS complex, oh, it went through both bundle and the speed in both right and left bundle are normal. Second beat, PR per O, that stops a bit longer at AV node. Third, a bizarre QRS, oh, there's no P, that means it's not from the atria. It's bizarre, it hasn't followed the conduction system of intraventricular, like conducting pathways, no bundle his, no right, left, it originated from the ventricle. These all concepts you have to generate whenever you see ECG with every complex. So it's so important to remember this pathway and contemplate when you're seeing ECG complex is it originating from the right point, and is it propagating in the right direction or not. And this is the conduction. We all know these are the very basics, so I'm not going into the details of that, that what conduction gives you which waves. So these are all you known to you, P wave, QRS, ventricular repolarization. Then this is also important to know the positions of leads, because this conduction, whichever is generated by the heart, it ultimately is recorded by these leads. And you have 12 different leads. You need to know position of every lead, where they are placed in limb leads or chest leads, and the principle of recording into these leads. Why is it important? Because a number of times your technicians do mistakes in terms of placing these leads. And if you know exactly the concept behind how these leads are recording, then you won't miss that. And one way or the other, you need to know that. So I justly go quickly go through the position and the concept, since we are not really here to learn that, but it's needed. So you can then further go and further consolidate your knowledge on these. We all know that limb leads, I'm just quickly going through, just give you a glimpse towards these. 1, 2, 3, AVR, AVL, chest leads, 12 chest leads at different positions. And this need to be known to you, the positions of every chest leads as well. Recording chest leads records the conduction in transverse plane, and limb leads in this vertical or longitudinal plane. Now the basics of recording is that normal cardiacs, we all know the axis is downward and to the left. That is, the wave of depolarization travels from the right atria towards left ventricular apex. If you take the net electrical forces, you'll come to know that the conduction starts from SA node, although this generated conduction ultimately depolarizes the conduction system as well as the whole myocardium cell to cell. And that's why you have this EP. You're recording now micro ECG. This is electrophysiology. You're recording exactly, putting the electrodes there and recording the conductions in different units of the myocardium. But in ECG, you can't do that. You record a conclusive recording of the electrical activity. That means whatever conduction went from SA node to AV node, what you are recording as a P wave, the conclusive multiples of all those recording. So the net vector is towards from SA to AV in normal conditions. Similarly, your ventricular conduction is same from AV to AV node to apex. The net conduction is in this fashion. You have the net conduction going on towards apex of the left ventricle. Now this is the conduction principles of ECG. Then think of the positive electrode of any lead as an I. That means if a lead is placed in this position, I'm very raw about the lead position, they're like this. Now everything in that lead, if that lead's position is here, then everything in that lead will be recorded positive, because the net electrical activity is going towards the positive end of that lead. Similarly, if your lead is here, like its positive is here, then everything in that lead will be recorded negative. And the same principles applied in different 12 angles. So whatever the angle will be, the lead or amplitudes of the waves will be according to that. That's the basic principle you need to know. I'm not going into much details, that when an electrical impulse travels towards a positive electrode, there will be a positive reflection of the ECG, simple. If the impulse travels from the positive electrode, a negative reflection away from the positive. And the example is like lead 2. Its positive is plus 60. If you make a circle, make a degrees, lead 2 will be at plus 60. So exactly parallel to the net cardiac electrical activity, and that's why you choose lead 2 for rhythm assessment, because you expect lead 2 to have best amplitudes, positive amplitudes, because its positive is exactly parallel to the net cardiac activity. That's why you get best possible P wave, best possible upright QRS and T in lead 2. Similarly, in AVR, AVR's positive is here. So you get everything negative in AVR. That's the basic principles of ECG recording. Now that means you need to know the positive of every lead and then contemplate looking at one lead and second and third, that if QRS is positive in 2, then it should be at least positive in 1 as well. It can't be possible that it's positive in 2 and positive in AVR as well. It's impossible. There is something wrong with ECG recording. You can't have electrical activity going simultaneously in two opposite direction. That's why it's important to know lead's position exactly and then make an impression looking at different QRS, that what's happening in different leads in terms of direction of net cardiac activity, electrical activity. So lead 1, 2, 3, these are the positive. We'll give you the handouts of this presentation. So at least try to recall or memorize the important things given in these handouts. And then certainly they will help you once you're interpreting the ECG. So, but whatever is given, it's really need to be memorized. 1, 2, 3, where the positive of these leads are. Similarly, AVL, AVF, AVR. The positive position. Now, axis determination is just this thing you are assessing by different formulas, that where the net cardiac activity is going on. I'll just tell you a simple formula, because telling you exact concept is running behind this. The lead position is recording principle and net cardiac activity. That you can read from different books, the real concept. I just tell you the basic formula of assessing and what's the normal axis is. Axis refer to the mean QRS axis vector during ventricular depolarization, the net vector. And normal axis is minus 30 to plus 90. And these are the formula you have to apply. Look at the lead 1 and 2. If both complexes are positive, then your axis is normal. If lead 1 is positive and 2 is negative, left axis deviation. Lead 1 is negative, 2 positive, right axis deviation. Both negative, indeterminate axis. You can't decide. It can be extreme left, it can be extreme right. Can anyone tell the axis of this ECG? What is the axis? Yeah. Left axis deviation, very good. Why? The QRS is positive in 1 and negative in 2. So just looking at these two leads quickly, the amplitudes, what's happening in 1 and what's happening in 2, can give you an idea what's wrong with the axis. Is it right axis, left axis, indeterminate or normal? Then this cardiac electivity, we are going from heart, surface anatomy, conduction system, leads, and now the paper. Ultimately, this cardiac activity from leads is recorded at paper. There are some basics you need to know about the ECG recordings on paper, very important, which is standardization. Can anyone tell me what is standardization? Can anyone?
The paper's moves and graphical standardization of the paper and graphic paper, the voltage and
it is, some people know, but the concepts are not clear about this standardization. ECG is a graph, and in this graph there is an x-axis, there is a y-axis. On x-axis you have time, on y-axis you have voltage. So that means you should have some standards of recording this x and y axis, whatever variables you are taking. There should be some standards for that, and this is called standardization. And the standards are, for x axis it's 25 millimeter per second. That means your paper speed will be so that in 1 second time your 25 millimeter will go through that stylus, or other way round, 1 second of cardiac activity will be recorded in 25 millimeter of ECG paper. And that's the basic, you can say, ek rule hai, uski buniyad pe you have subsequent time duration, whatever your QRS duration, PR interval, whatever, is all dependent on this standard. And that's why you say that one large square is 0.2 seconds. Why? Because five large squares are in 1 second, and this standard can be changed according to requirements. And it's important to see whether your ECG is recorded on these standards or not. That's again very important. Similarly, y-axis you have voltage, which means 10 millimeter per millivolt. What it means? It means that 1 millivolt generated electrical activity will move your stylus 10 millimeter up or down, and that can be changed as well. But your normal standards calculations are dependent on that you have made these standards. Your machine is recording according to these standards. That's very important. And sometimes your technician can do mistakes and change the standards, or sometimes you may need to record on different standards. Then what you have to do, you have to make your calculation according to the change standards. Like if you are recording an ECG on 50 millimeter per second, that means now your 1 second activity is recorded in 50 millimeter rather than 25 millimeter. So whatever you are calculating, you have to make it double of actual. Jaise rate kisi ka agar 70 hai to usme 40 aayega. QRS narrow hai to QRS broad ho jayega, aur aapko usko consider karna padega ki ab wahi same activity डबल पेपर में रिकॉर्ड हो रही है. सिमिलरली उसको तेज भी कर सकते हैं, स्पीड 12.5 भी कर सकते हैं. किसी को बहुत ब्रेडिकार्डिया है, हमारे यहाँ देखते हैं वो ECG उसी तरह रिकॉर्ड हो रही होती है. वो ये बेचारा इतना सारा पेपर यूज हो रहा है उसमें, भाई आप उसको 12.5 कर दें और कैलकुलेशन में उसको कंटेम्पलेट कर लें. वही चीज जो आप रिदम स्ट्रिप में इतने बड़े पेपर में रिकॉर्ड कर रहे हैं, वो इतने में रिकॉर्ड हो जाएगी. एंड जस्ट व्हाट एवर यू आर कैलकुलेटिंग, उसको आप डबल कर लें. अगर वो 120 का रेट है तो वो आधा हो जाएगा, इसको हाफ कर लें सॉरी. और ज्यादा में रिकॉर्ड करते हैं तो डबल कर लें, और हर कैलकुलेशन को वो उससे चेंज कर लें. सिमिलरली वोल्टेज बहुत एक्सुबरेंट्स आ रहे हैं तो हाफ कैलकुलेशन पे रिकॉर्ड कर लें और उसको फिर एडजस्ट कर लें. 1/4 कैलकुलेशन पे रिकॉर्ड कर लें, उसको एडजस्ट कर लें. बहुत छोटी आ रही है, पेरिकार्डियल इफ्यूजन है, तो 20 पे रिकॉर्ड कर लें तो एम्पलीट्यूड्स बढ़ के आ जाएंगे, पी है नहीं है सब कुछ पता चल जाएगा. दिस इज देयर टू यूटिलाइज इन डिफरेंट कंडीशंस, वट एवर योर कोरिलेशन विद इलेक्ट्रिकल एक्टिविटी एंड योर वोल्टेज इज देयर, और इलेक्ट्रिकल एक्टिविटी विद रेट इज देयर, यू कैन एडजस्ट योर स्टैंडर्ड्स टू रियली फैसिलिटेट योर ECG रिकॉर्डिंग. And then contemplate according to the changes whatever you have made in standardization. So that is very important to know. And always check standardization. Ye aksar hota hai, we got calls from hospitals that your patient ki ECG mein gadbad hai,
operation multavi. Cardiologist aayega to dekhega. And I went there, saw the patient, heart rate 80, 90, no cardiac background, nothing. ECG, sinus brady and bundle branch block and PR interval prolonged. What you expect? Recorded at 50. So just written that, just repeat ECG at normal standard and operation. So we are not looking at the clinicals, we are looking at anesthesia. Wale ne file mangai thi, niche file mein bas wo dekha aur bahar nahi, cardiologist ko call karo, abhi main isko nahi kar sakta. Now usne standard ko dekha ke kya hai, kis pe record hua hai, aur ye aksar hota hai. Aur ek aur cheez badi important hai ki aapko ECG karni aani chahiye. Those who are in NICVD, they should do ECGs by themselves. क्योंकि ये मुमकिन हो सकता है कहीं आप ऐसी जगह हो, ECG मशीन भी हो, मरीज भी दर्द से तड़प रहा हो और SK भी पड़ा हुआ हो, सब कुछ हो, टेक्नीशियन ना आया हो. एंड डॉक्टर साहब हाथ बांध के बैठे रहेंगे फिर कि आज तो कुछ भी नहीं हो सकता क्योंकि ECG करनी नहीं आती. How can it be possible you are utilizing a tool and you don't know how to handle it? And this is the golden place to learn how to do ECG. Limb leads, chest leads by yourself, ECG machines, different varieties.